So tonight, we're really fortunate to have a former William Patterson student, an alum, if you will. It wasn't probably so long ago that he, like most of you, was sitting in a lecture hall, much like this, had dreams, aspirations, wishes, things that he wanted to accomplish, goals along the way. And as we're going to find out as the evening progresses, along the way, there are some interesting moments and there are opportunities. So what I wanted to do, Rob, is sort of, you know, wake up some of your brain cells and maybe perhaps start off and say to you, like, you heard this song, maybe you can tell us a little bit about it.
Well, Irwin
Levine. Right. Well,
I'm coming home, I've done my time. Now I've got to know what is and isn't mine.
If most of you familiar with the song?
See my letter telling you I'd soon
anybody?
Be free.
Bueller? Anyone?
Then you'll know just what to do.
You guys have not heard this
if
song before?
You still want me. If you still want me.
Wow.
What time?
Now you know.
Do you still want me? If I don't see a ribbon around the old oak tree, I'll stay on the bus, forget about us, put the blame on me. If I don't see a yellow ribbon around the old oak tree.
Okay, so I don't know if there's a more poppy or whiter song that you've heard in a long time, but tell me about how that song came about in your life.
Irwin, the composer of that song, actually lived in the same town I grew up in. And I used to, when I first started making demos, I used to always carry around, at the time it was a cassette. And long story short, my mother, growing up, somehow befriended Connie Francis, who is an old 50s singer. She her hits were "Fusari Now," "Where the Boys Are." Trying to, you know, just at that point, I was, you know, in my 20s. I was just looking for any way to get the engine started. Just looking for, I don't even want to call it a break. I was just, I didn't have the plan, but I used to carry around a cassette of the songs that I had written at the time. And I had seen Irwin backstage one evening. I believe it was at, I want to say the PNC Arts Center, which it wasn't called that at the time. I think it was the Garden State Arts Center. Right. And I had seen Irwin backstage, and I took the cassette out of my pocket, and I introduced myself as an aspiring songwriter. And I said, I'd really appreciate it if you could, you know, give this a listen. And it was really rough. At the time, I had a Korg M1 keyboard, which I used to do everything on. It had a sequencer in it. And the sequencer was really rough. It would you know, quantize things, meaning it would fix, you know, timing in a very primitive way. So long story short, it was pretty horrific, the presentation, but it was all I had, and I would do this in my bedroom with the one keyboard. So I give the demo to Irwin that night, and he actually, I would put my phone number on the cassette, you know, like where the label is. I wouldn't label the songs. And he called me the next day, and he invited me to his house. And it just started a two-year writing binge. Him and I just connected, and you know, it was really my introduction to songwriting. It was my introduction into a lyricist, like, because my lyrics compared to his were garbage, and he was the person who enlightened me how to really develop a hook to a song, how to keep it simple. You know, he would sit with his yellow pad And I would just watch him sometimes in awe, you know, develop these lyrics and song ideas. I mean, at that time, I was more on the side of, you know, melody, and you know, I was playing the keyboard, and he would just sit and do lyrics and melody with me. But he was definitely my first true collaboration and my entrance. I mean, we didn't get anything going on. We tried, you know, we shopped. He was tight with Clive Davis. We sent stuff to Clive. You know, Irwin had this thing. He would only send things that were really extra special. He wouldn't use that relationship all the time. It had to be what Irwin felt as a great, great song.
How old were you when this was happening?
I was still actually going here. I was still attending college here, so I'm going to look, you know, to say early 20s.
And how old was Irwin at the time?
Irwin was probably late 50s. And it was actually, I mean, it was sad because we lost Irwin about, you know, 6-7 years ago. And it was before I had my first hit record and broke into the business, and it was something that I would have loved to shared with him, because he would have definitely celebrated hardcore with me, but we didn't get to do that. But I always remember him as my first true songwriting collaboration, and I really learned. I mean, it was I can't tell you the amount of wealth, knowledge.
Well, that song, most of you were unfamiliar with, at least initially. It's recorded by Tony Orlando and Dawn, and numerous times people would put yellow ribbons around their trees, hoping their soldiers or family members would come back from the war.
That's right. They still do, yeah.
I don't like overusing the word, but that song and the lyrics have become extraordinarily iconic. So it's no surprise that when you got the opportunity to work with somebody like that,
absolutely,
you grabbed it. And that's sort of the beginning. The roots of your, like, professional career.
It was, and I wouldn't even term it as professional. It was. I would leave here, and I would go right there, and you know, vice versa. If I had a night class here, I would be there all day, working with Irwin. And even if he wasn't there, he basically, you know, he gave me a key to the house, and we built like a really small, like $6,000 studio setup. And you know, I still have some of those tapes, and they're. On my part, they're pretty awful. Like, I listen back, you know, because I was doing all the production, because it's like I wanted to get into this as a songwriter, but I realized really quickly that, you know, it was going to be really tough to get people to demo the songs we were doing. So I kind of took over that role as the in-house producer and arranger, if you will. So Irwin and I would write the songs. He would go upstairs, you know, he would go to the movies, whatever, and he would lead me down in the basement to kind of put together a working demo track of the song, which it kind of forced me into production in a weird way, because I never thought, you know, I would be a producer. But that was, I guess, in retrospect, a great thing that happened, because it made me do it. And again, listening back to some of that stuff, it was pretty horrific, but it was my start, and it was a huge, huge learning experience.
So you're a student here at William Patterson, and all your free time is hanging out with a man who's old enough to be your dad.
Yep, every waking second.
So then what happens?
So then, you know, it's getting frustrating, because, you know, it's funny, because Irwin would, like, I started to realize when Irwin would receive like an ASCAP or a royalty check, because he came downstairs and he had a whole different demeanor those days. And, you know, then he started to show me some of his, you know, some of the checks he was making, to kind of basically to let me know there was hope for me, because I think he saw I was kind of like, oh, I don't know. I mean, I'm here all the time. I love this, but do I need to start getting serious about my life? I mean, he's making money off Tie Yellow Ribbon, Knock Three Times was another one of his hits. He had, you know, a string of hits that he has a steady income from. But I'm hungry. I wanna get there, but I'm not seeing any progress. I'm seeing everything coming back with no response. You know, we send stuff to Clive.
That's Clive Davis, who at the time was chairman of Arista
Records, right. And, you know, he had Whitney, and we, you know, Irwin and I would always try to do, like, we would shoot big. We would try to do Whitney's song or, you know, someone that we knew Clyde was working on because there was that relationship with Irwin. But it was like every time we sent something, like, we never got word, and him and I would just, like, wait 2 days. And we knew, like, after 2 days that we weren't getting word because Clive, like I said, he had known that Clive would, when he loved something, he would respond immediately.
And he had a very special, unique relationship with Clive Davis because some of his biggest hits, as recorded by Tony Orlando and Dawn, were on the antecedent to Arista Records, which was Bell, where Clive was also working. So here's one of his tunesmiths that Clive would go to, and he would recognize and say, this guy knows his stuff. So
Right. You
had a privileged access, I would think.
Right, but I think it was in some way, but I think at this point in time, Irwin had... his time was up, you know, and I didn't realize that because I wasn't really thinking that way. But, you know, the stuff we were doing was, in fact, it did sound dated now in retrospect, but, you know, I was going to take whatever I can get.
So you think maybe there was something in the back of his head like, you know, I know I'm sort of out of fresh. Here's a young guy who I think is talented, and maybe he can help me spin around and have a second shot at the merry-go-round?
Yes, definitely. But it was like, I guess I was thinking the opposite way.
Right.
You know, and he was thinking that way, and I think we just kind of, like I would rely on him more maybe for the creative elements that I should have been relying on myself more, you know, and vice versa. So I think us not sitting down maybe and just having some sort of discussion about that may have hurt us in a way, because again, I was thinking like he was going to be the guy to do it for me, and maybe he was thinking I was going to be the guy to do it for him. So I was letting him do a lot of, you know, what he did, the lyrics and, you know, more of the, you know, some of the writing on the melodies. But I think it should have been flipped in retrospect, you know, because it might have worked out differently.
So the lesson that everyone can absorb from this part of the conversation is when the opportunity knocks and you get an opportunity to work with somebody who could be possibly your mentor, you take that and you grab it and you ride it for as long as you can.
No question about it. No question about it. But I mean, I guess there's a way to do it, you know, where you're understanding the situation is important too, not just going in kind of like, oh, you know, this guy's gonna make me a hit songwriter and, you know, I'm gonna, you know, just ride off the situation, because that's kind of what I did. And that's not, I mean, I learned songwriting, but it could have went either way in terms of that could have been, you know, it for me, because it was a lot of time spent doing demos that just didn't do anything. And it was very discouraging in that way. So, but yeah, I mean, absolutely you take the opportunity. But I think, you know, go in with a realistic viewpoint and, you know, just be smart about it. And I know it's easier said than done, but I think knowing what you're bringing to the table, knowing what other people are bringing to the table in that kind of creative relationship is key. Because, you know, I always say, like, people do what they do. It's like for me to have, you know, to have thought that Irwin was going to write the next MC Hammer record wouldn't have been realistic. But, you know, he had a very specific talent, but I don't think I honed in enough on what his talent was and tried to make it work for the period we were in. You know what I mean? I think if I went in a little bit smarter with it, I could have turned it around even for him.
But that's
part of learning.
Monday morning quarterbacking.
Sure, exactly.
But it did provide you an entree, and I want to try to see if I can get this to play another track, see if this will...
Things just ain't the way that they used to be. Back in the day when a man meant security. Working hard all week, baby, kick back and throw up your feet. Let me fix your luxury, say it might be a little bit sweet.
But he's worth it. Yeah. He deserves it. May not be perfect. He's all the man I need. He's ready and willing. Gives me the feeling.
And whenever we're together, I know where I belong.
So maybe we're skipping ahead a little bit.
Right.
But there's definitely a connection there.
Right. I mean, with the Whitney thing. Yeah.
With Clive Davis, because right. obviously he handcrafts every one of her records. That's from her, not her most recent album, but
before, yeah.
I think, yeah, it was like yeah. 2 or 3 years ago.
Yeah.
And so that's a song you
wrote and produced.
Clive
was out of the situation at that point, that was Ellie Reid. But still, obviously, she comes, you know, groomed and all those hits from Clive originally. And this is where Ellie Reid.
So this is a first entree to Ellie Reid then?
It is, yeah.
Which we'll come back to later in tonight's
right.
discussion. But so how does that come about? I mean, here you are struggling with Irwin and you're a William Patterson student.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden you got a song on a Whitney Houston record.
Right, just to glaze over it. Irwin had a flood in his house, like a really bad flood. We had a rainstorm and the whole studio basically was like washed out except for like 3 pieces of gear. And I went over there and I was so upset because here was my $6,000 investment basically underwater. And I left Irwin's that day with the 3 pieces that were left, you know, still standing, that were dry. And I just told him, I'm like, I think that's it for me. I think that's the straw that broke the camel's back. So I took the it was like a keyboard, a mixer, and like a reverb unit, and I took it home, and I put it, I was still living at my mom's, and I put it in my bedroom. And I just started making records there by myself. Long story short, my mom basically is like, enough of that studio in the bedroom thing, like move it downstairs. I move it downstairs, start working in the basement. But I get a job in the meantime because I'm basically broke and I gotta, you know, try to start making some money. So I get a job at a consulting firm doing information technology. Doesn't last, I get fired. I tell my mom I'm gonna try music for a year. She's like, you know, she's almost in tears hearing that from me. But I'm like, give me a year, and if nothing happens, you know, I'll go back to the job, I promise. So sure enough, a year passes and nothing happens. I just don't talk about it with her at that point. I just kind of avoid the topic. So I somehow last another 6 months downstairs. So now it's a year and 6 months. She comes down. My mom comes down one morning at like 4 a.m. and she's like, what are you doing? She's like, what are you doing? She's like, you're killing yourself. She's like, this is not gonna work. I'm like, maybe, maybe not. But I'm gonna try to ride it as long as I can. I think 2 or 3 months later, a buddy of mine comes over and he brings with him a fellow by the name of Vince Herbert. Vince Herbert at the time was producing. He had just done Toni Braxton. He did Aaliyah. And my buddy happened to be with him that day when he stopped over at my place. And he came downstairs, we talked a little bit. They asked me what I was working on. I happened to be working on a record called No, No, No. I had recorded the hook with a male vocalist. I thought it might be a male song, but it didn't go that way. But Vince, I play the song for Vince. Vince flips out, asks me for a copy of the song. I give him a copy of the song. He's like, I'm working with this group that I think the song would be good for. The group happens to be Destiny's Child. He tells me, I'm like, well, I never heard of them. He's like, it's their first album. He's telling me a little bit about them. I'm like, you know, take it and try it. He plays the song for the label. The next day he calls me and he's like, we're cutting the song tonight on this group, Destiny's Child. He's like, I'm sending over 4 DA88 machines, which were digital machines at the time, so you could track the record. I had never tracked a record in my life, so it was all just like by the seat of my pants. The next night after that, I'm in the studio for the first time in a real studio, and Vince puts me behind the console with Beyonce in the booth. And he's like, do the vocals with Beyonce. And I'm like, I don't even know how to do vocals. Like, what do you mean do the vocals? So again, just learning by the seat of my pants. Here I'm telling, in retrospect, it seems so silly telling Beyonce how to sing this record. But it was my song and it was my production. So I just kind of went with it. At that point, we finished the record. Vince had, however he did, he got a guarantee from the label for it to be their first single. On the album, the Destiny's Child's first album, at that point, Vince invites me to Los Angeles. I wind up, he says it's for a week.
Now you've never, other than that encounter in the studio, it's the only time you've ever met anybody from Destiny's Child.
Totally.
That met the manager.
Nobody.
Just all of a sudden there's this woman in a booth and go teach her how to sing my song.
And it was interesting because now in retrospect, here's Vince handling all the business in the back, you know, basically taking all the money and taking, you know, doing the deal. And here's me up in the front doing all the work. And this went on for, you know, he's like, you know, I need you to, I really would love you for you to come out to LA for 2 weeks. I'm working on Montel Jordan, Master P, Bones, Thugs, and Harmony at the time. And I'm like, of course. Because it was my, this was the real entrance for me into the game. So 2 weeks turns into 2 years. And Vince and I did some, probably 30 records in those 2 years for just a massive amount of artists. And you know, and obviously I'm just skimming to get to the Whitney thing. By year two, I'm like, you know what? I'm not seeing any documents. I'm not seeing any real money. You know, Vince makes sure I don't have a car. So I'm basically, he gets me an apartment, and he just kind of like, he picks me up from the apartment, drives me to the studio. After the studio, he drives me right back to the apartment.
And you, those of you who don't understand the psychology of Los Angeles, there's no mass transit. I mean, there are buses, but they really aren't. So if you don't have a car in Los Angeles, you're stranded. There's no way to get around. I guess you could get a taxi, but you know, those are few and far between also. So understand, he's in an apartment by design. He can't go. He can't even go. You can't even get something to eat.
No, nothing. Right. No, he would actually bring me food. It was like
you are a kept man.
Yeah, it was like prison. And to top it off, he's paying me in cash, whatever little bit he's paying me, because when I would like, I'd have to get on him for like everything. Like, you know, I'm working. You know, I had an MPC, a drum machine in the apartment, and even just to get like the floppy disk to save my beats on, I had to like. Go crazy calling this guy day in, day out for floppy disks. So to get money was just, it was out of the question. But when I would finally, you know, get payments, they were in cash. And here I don't even have a bank account. So I'm like, I'm stuffing cash all over the apartment, under the TV, like everywhere. Finally, I'm just like, this is ridiculous, because, you know, I'm getting word now from people inside the business, like he's getting $50,000-$60,000 per track, because at that time now R&B is so big and the business is so fruitful that it's like this is the high point of R&B, and really probably one of the high points for the music business in terms of producers, because here now producers start to become the highlighted person. It starts to become about the producer as much as it is about the artist, and Vince starts to become one of those guys through the work that I'm giving him.
And if, correct me if I'm wrong, but the R&B crossover era was such that there wasn't just one producer for an album. It's like different producers and production for each song, and then it was a mixer. So it had become the era of a production company per song.
Totally. That, and there's like 5, sometimes 10 writers on a song. Like I would get the credits back to a song sometimes, or I would see the album rather, on a song that I would work on. And I would see like these 6 names that I had no idea who they were on my song. So this just went on for like, two
years.
These
are people that you never met?
Never met.
Did they add anything to the song?
No, I'd never even seen these people. Never met them.
And these were names attached to your creative work.
And then I think like for me, the straw that broke the camel's back was on one record, it said all instruments Vince Herbert. And Vince Herbert doesn't even play an instrument. So I was just like, you know, I'm like, it's out of control. Out of control. So the night that I decide to leave Los Angeles and come back to Jersey. I'll never forget it. We were at the record plant, and I was in, there's 3 or 4 studios in there, and I was in one studio working with Tatiana Lee, which was Will Smith's artist. She was the girl who played on Fresh Prince. And in room A was Prince working on his record, and room B was Jimmy Page and Puffy doing that thing for the movie. And it really hit me that I'm like, I'm not making any money here. Like, I don't know what I'm doing. So I say to Vince, it just came over me. I'm like, for whatever reason, I decided that night I was gonna go home, and I said, Vince, that's it, I'm done. I gotta go. I've had my fill. And it was funny because he it was like he knew it was coming. Like, cause it was like he had been down this road before. So he's like, he didn't say like, let's work this out or let me do something to try and make you stay. I'll never forget his words. He's like, have a safe trip home. And he's like, call me when you get home. And I was like, that was the oddest reaction from somebody I just told that I was leaving their camp.
But if you had any doubts at that moment, whether you were doing the right thing or wrong thing, that you're surely vanquished any of that, because you must have realized then for certain that you were making the right decision by packing up.
I did. I mean, look, I can't say Vince wasn't doing anything, because he was the guy who was running around, like meeting with the labels. He was the personality who was doing the deals. You know, it was like I could have went 70-30 in his favor. I could even went, you know, somewhere, you know, 60-40, whatever. It could have been worked out, but it was like here's a sandwich and $1,000, you know, and he's making $50,000-$60,000. So it was like there was no doubt. It was like where am I going here? So I head back to Jersey, and I just start hitting the phone. And I on that session that last night, I had met Omar Rambert, who was at the time representing Will because of the Tatiana, you know, relationship. And when I got back, you know, to Jersey, I called Omar and I said, you know, I'm kind of on my own now, and I'm going to be doing production, you know, without Vince. And he's like, oh, it's a good move. And I'm like, if anything comes up, you know, give me a buzz. And sure enough, like a month or so later, he's like, I'm working on this movie with Will, Wild Wild West. And he's like, we've been using Trackmasters a lot, but, you know, they're really expensive and we want to start venturing out to some of the producers. He's like, if you have anything or you have any ideas, you know, please let me know. So I did an idea for Will with a sample, because I knew Will had to have a sample, because that was his whole, you know, his whole thing, his whole gimmick. So I did the Stevie Wonder I Wish sample, and I
let's play a little bit of it.
Sure.
Jim West, Desperado, Rough Rider, no, you don't want nada, none of this, six gunning this, brother running this, Buffalo Soldier, look, it's like I told you, any damsel that's in distress, be out of that dress when she meet Jim West, rough neck, so go check the lawn and buy, watch your step, we'll flex and get a hole in your side, swallow your pride, don't let your lip react, you don't wanna see my hand where my hip be at, with Artemis, from the start of this, running the game, James West, taming the West, so remember the name, now who you gonna call,
not the GB,
now who you gonna call,
Shane.
If you ever riff with people wanna bust,
break out
before you get bum rushed at
the Wild Wild West.
When I roll into the
Wild Wild West,
when I stroll into the
Wild Wild West,
when I bounce into
the Wild Wild West,
Cisco,
Cisco.
Once upon a time in the West, madman lost his damn mind in the West. Loveless, kidnapped or die, nothing less. Now I must put his behind to the test. Then through the shadows, in the saddle, ready for battle. Bring all your poison, it kind of poison. Behind my back, all that riffing you did. Front and center, now where you look back, kid.
I call it the Wild Wild Mess. Is the way that turned out. It turned out to be a terrible experience. Actually, I went to see the movie the night it opened, and it was me and like two other people, because it was like on the, you know how it's Thursday night, it opens for the 12 o'clock for the Friday release. And I didn't even mind that the movie was really terrible, but what I did mind is that at waiting for my name at the end on the credits and they leave me off. And I just remember sitting in the theater by myself, just like, I couldn't move. I was like paralyzed. Like, just, I didn't know what to do.
So lesson number one, make sure you get paid.
Right.
By the right guy. Lesson number two, make sure you get the proper credit when your music is used in other media.
Right. You know, lesson three is don't get emotional. And I did that, and I called Will's manager that night, and I just, I couldn't contain myself. And that was the last time we spoke. And at that point, it turned into, well, it was Stevie Wonder got 50% and a $500,000 advance for the use of the sample. Cisco got $90,000 to do the vocal on the hook.
How many of you have heard of Cisco? Okay, good.
Cisco and got the $90,000. Kumo D for the Wawa West part got 5% of the publishing. So the rest was left for me and Will, was the agreement that I had with Will to split the remaining publishing. Because, you know, it was very much a joint effort with me and Will, kind of, I don't want to say I wrote his rap, but we were doing lyrics together. So it wasn't just I was a track guy at that point. It was me writing lyrics with Will for the rap. After that whole thing, where I kind of freaked out, they were like, well, you know what, we're not doing, we're not splitting it with you. They're like, we'll give you, I think they offered me like 4%. And I'm like, no way. I'm like, I'm not taking it. And it just went into this whole legal mess, and I wound up with 4%.
But you still get residuals, I would assume, today when it's shown on cable and, you know, when it's screened. The DVD rights?
Yep. I still get royalties from it. And actually, pretty good royalties with the minimal...
4%.
But, you know, it was me, you know, learning stuff the hard way. It was me really going through school of hard knocks here, because...
You didn't learn it here at William Patterson?
I did, but I mean, you know, I should have probably paid attention a little more in some of these classes, to tell you the truth.
Lesson number 5, pay attention.
Yeah, because a lot of this was covered, and, you know, my head was probably just in the clouds at that point.
So we still haven't gotten to the L.A. Reid Whitney part.
So Wawa West happens. I stay in touch with Matthew Knowles. We wind up working on the third Destiny's Child album together, a Survivor album. Once again, it's a sample track that they're interested in. That starts it off, which was the Stevie Nicks sample. Again, by this point, I was like, you know, why do we have to give Stevie Nicks 50% for the guitar loop? So I approached Matthew, and I'm like, Matthew, we gotta replay this sample. I mean, this is gonna be such a waste to give Stevie Nicks. I could replace it with a keyboard part, I think, you know, or anything. I didn't think that it was such an integral part of the record that it needed to be in there. But, you know, he disagreed. And was he right? I don't know. I mean, we'll never know. He felt that the sound and the feel of the original in there was important.
By the way, Matthew Knowles is Beyonce's dad, and he is the, for lack of a better word, manager at the time of Destiny's Child. Today, currently, allegedly, is her manager as well. Right. So he's saying to you, it's an integral part, and the recreation of that won't do it justice.
Right.
You have to have the original sample.
Right, he was afraid we were going to lose something. You know, at that point, you know, Beyonce and I are just doing lyrics and stuff over the phone. Like, I never stepped into the studio to do a vocal with her on that whole album. I did 4 songs on the album, everything over the phone. And I would send the tracks out to wherever they were on tour, and she would cut the vocals and send it back to me, and I would work from that. But we never stepped into the studio together to create at that point. But I mean, it was still, you know, I love her writing. When she sent back Bootylicious, I was a little disappointed, because I thought what we had kind of come up with over the phone was a little bit different and a little bit more exciting and fresh. But you know what? It was her call, and I had to go with it.
Let's listen to a little bit of that.
Kelly, can you handle this? Michelle.
So who came up with the adjective bootylicious?
She did.
Okay.
Beyonce all the way.
So that's why
I think it would have been odd if I came up with it, I think, too. And it's funny because there's I don't know how it got misconstrued in Billboard. I did a thing last week, an interview, and like people think, like they read it as I wasn't giving her credit, I was taking credit. It wasn't that at all. If you read the interview, it was, she was on an interview and she had said in the interview that she was listening to the Stevie Nicks track, and that's how she kind of came up with the idea for the track. And again, it was like, oh my God, it was like Will Smith, Wild West all over again for me, seeing the interview.
I just don't see Beyonce sitting at home listening to Stevie Nicks records.
Right, right.
That just doesn't seem...
Right, it was another dagger for me, and I made the same mistake. I called Matthew, and I was emotional. And I was like, Matthew, what is going on here? And he was just, you know, and it wasn't like, it wasn't a heated conversation. He was like, Rob, just, you know, it's not about you, bro. Like, he basically said it in his own way. He's like, it's not about you. You can't, you know, this isn't about you. It's about the artist. You got to step back and let this be about the artist 100%. And I'm like, I get it. I get it. And again, like, it was just like, I don't know. I wasn't looking for accolades. I wasn't looking for recognition. It was just, I was like, you're trying to establish your name and your likeness as a producer. And it seemed like every time I was doing this, I was getting kind of pushed back to the side. And it just started to really, it started to mess with me.
So do you think it would have made a difference for you after these several experiences if you had aligned yourself with somebody who you trusted, who could represent your interests? There's always the thought where, you know, there's a reason to have a manager, because the artist, and I'll put you in that frame, an artist shouldn't get their hands dirty with the business side of things.
Absolutely. Big mistake, yeah.
So you calling up Matthew Knowles,
yep,
had somebody who has much more colder, or the woman who represented Jay Leno said, before he fired her, she said, I fed you steak, but I never showed you how I slaughtered the cow.
Right.
And, you know, that analogy for you would have been, maybe, would have changed things?
Absolutely. I thought being hands-on was the move. I thought, let me have, you know, control kind of over my dealings and relationships. Because I was like, I wanted to nurture these relationships, and I wanted to talk to people, but it backfired for me in a big way. Because I'm emotional because it's my work, you know, it's like, maybe, and I'm not saying like a Puffy or one of these guys that they don't actually do the work. I'm not insinuating that at all. I'm just, maybe they're more about the business. Like this guy Vince, who is, you know, the guy who was selling all these beats, you know, over me. He wasn't about the music. He was just about keeping those, you know, those relationships alive and doing whatever he had to do to do the lunches and to make everybody feel comfortable. You know, for me, being about the music, it's tricky because it's like, it's your babies. Like, all these songs were my babies. And then here I see Beyonce talking about it, and she doesn't mention Rob. I see Will, you know, talking about Wild Wild West, and there's no mention of Rob. And I'm like, wow. And now I'm like seeing there's definitely a pattern here. I mean, is it something I'm doing? And sure enough, it once again repeats itself with Lady Gaga. So now I have to start looking at myself. Like, is it something that I'm doing?
We're not doing.
Right.
Okay, so you have your moment with Matthew Knowles and Destiny's Child. Then what happens?
We smooth that over. I wind up doing a good portion of the next album, which is a Christmas album for the girls. And, you know, it's cool. I mean, I go in to meet Matthew after that to work on the next album. And to talk about Beyonce starts her solo stuff, but he made it real clear that, excuse me, Beyonce wanted to take it a totally different direction than the Destiny's Child stuff. So he basically made it clear that I wasn't going to be working on any of the Beyonce solo stuff because she didn't want to sound anything like the Destiny stuff. So that's, you know, that's at that point. But Matthew kind of he was like, but I'd like to manage you. So we started talking about management. And he, you know, he put me with a couple things to in good faith, like, so he put me with like the OJs,
right,
and like Donna Summer or something, like some, like just some stuff that he was just like not really concentrating on. And then that keep you busy. Right, and that told a story for me right then and there, because it was like, all right, he's just gonna kind of push me to the side and not have me work on priority. Like, I should be working on Beyonce and like the main stuff, within arm's length
right. If he needed you.
Right. Anyway, long story short, I never wind up signing the deal with him. He gets really upset with that. And that was probably the last time we spoke, was during that whole.
So then how did this come to being this song then?
For whatever reason, I kind of hit it off with Kelly. Like, always, like, when I would go see the girls perform and I would go back, I was always kind of hanging out with Kelly. She's such a sweetheart that I always would gravitate to her. It was like, Beyonce always kind of, for me, was a little aloof, and it was like kind of, she was a little cold at, times to me. So I'd always gravitate to Kelly. So working on Kelly's solo record was, it just seemed natural. And Matthew was managing Kelly as well on the solo project. And it's funny because they just put me in the studio with her to try some stuff. And the A&R person, I had cut two songs, this being one of them, and the same night. And the A&R person, I won't say the name, it doesn't matter, comes in that night and was like, I don't like either of these songs. So she was like, no. And like, I think like 20 minutes later, Matthew comes in. He's like, well, let me hear them, because she tells him that she doesn't like him, but he's like, he wants to hear him anyway. And he's like, we're using both of these songs. So that's how that train on the track came about with Kelly. It almost didn't get on there, because I think if Matthew didn't come into the studio that night, the A&R person would have just X'd him off, because she didn't like him. So I got lucky on that one. And that's where Matthew kind of worked to my advantage, being there that night.
So he did have some redeeming value in your world.
He did.
So you and Matthew decide, or you decide to part ways with Matthew, or not stay with him, and he gets upset.
Yeah.
And then what happens to Rob?
Matthew kind of just like, he made it real clear that even like the dealings that we had, the last couple of dealings we had, that he was going to get the upper hand on it. And he said to me, he's like, well, I'm going to use these OJ's records, but since the guys are, I forget how he termed it, he was like, since the guys are such legends, they're going to take half of your publishing. I'm like, what? I'm like, no. He's like, I told you that when you initially signed on to do the project. I'm like, no, you didn't. And he actually, it's funny because he goes, he's like, I told you that, and I had an attorney in the room tell you that. I'm like, Matthew, that is not true. And I call, and this was on a conference call, and I kind of called him a liar on the conference call, and that was the last time I spoke to him.
So the outcome of the OJ's publishing?
They didn't get any. But the record didn't sell any, so it was like they could have had it all.
Right. Right. So, okay.
That's a good example. Maybe I could have saved face on the relationship and gave him the publishing, because it was such a, it was such a, it wasn't like an important project, and it wasn't going to do well, and I knew that, but it was like the principle of here's like, again, you know, somebody just taking.
So do you want 100, you know, the moral of the story is, do you want 100% of nothing,
right,
or half of something that's huge,
right,
or could be?
Right. But it was clear to me at that point that he wasn't going to put me on Beyonce's. I wanted to be on Beyonce. I was like, Matthew, I need to be working on Beyonce's stuff. I mean, I could reform and change my style to do what she's doing, or we could do something. It doesn't have to sound like Destiny's Child. But he was real clear, and it was like, it was going south because I was really pushing to stay in the relationship with Matthew to do Beyonce, not to do the OJs, not to do the Spinners, and whatever else it was that he was trying to have me do. So it was, you know, it was going south, and it just went south. And that was the last time we spoke.
So then what?
So then, you know, I'm kind of back on my own, like, you know, no manager. At this time, I started talking to David Sonnenberg to come on board to manage me, because I started realizing that I needed a manager, and I needed somebody quick and somebody really kind of hardcore. And at that time, David had just signed on with the Black Eyed Peas, but he had the Fugees too, and he was managing both groups. And he was just so focused on the Fugees and the Black Eyed Peas that it was like, I would, you know, I signed a deal with him, management. And it just seemed like I was really on the low end of the totem pole. You know, every time I would call David, it was just like, I'll get back to you like tomorrow, you know, or the next day. So I didn't nurture that relationship much with David. Again, in retrospect, probably could have been a mistake, because seeing what, you know, what he did with the Black Eyed Peas and some of his other acts, it might have been a good camp to be in, but my lack of patience kind of worked against me on that one.
But the truism there is, as good as manager David is and as talented as, if you're not going to get the priority and you're not going to be on his A-list, then it's not the right place for you to be.
Right, but there was no way I was going to get the priority if Fugees are selling out Wembley Stadium. You know what I mean? So it was unrealistic for me to even think that, but I did think that. You're right. It was like, no, I just did Bootylicious. I just, you know, I did 3 number one Hot 100 songs. Like, no, I need somebody who's gonna be fighting for me on the regular. Needless to say, I never found, to this day, I still never found that person who is just hitting the street like hardcore. I mean, because we'll talk even in a little bit about, you know, who was representing me during Gaga and how that backfired.
Right.
In a big way for me.
So, all right, so Sonnenberg represents you, and that's not going anywhere.
Right, so that I stayed on for like 6 months with David, and then we parted ways. This kind of brings us up to the Whitney record. I didn't do the record for Whitney. I had just demoed a song that I liked, that I wrote, and I wanted to put a demo down. And it got into the hands through, not even me, to L.A. Reid, through a girl, Aritza, that I had written a song with. And I got a call from L.A. Reid's office about the record. They said, we want to play this record for Whitney, but we want to change the demo singer on it. And I was like, that was a new one for me, because it was a strange request. It was like Whitney had to hear it with this particular girl that they used to demo all the songs. So I had to actually recut the record with their demo singer, and then they would play it for Whitney.
What was the difference between the two vocalists?
The first one was better.
But the other one's more familiar.
I guess Whitney, you know, was comfortable, whatever, with this girl just singing everything. Maybe it was because she didn't out-sing Whitney. I don't know what, maybe Whitney didn't want to hear anybody better than her. Right. I don't know. But, so, wound up doing it. Whitney loves the record. And the Whitney session happens in Miami. They fly me down to Miami to do vocals with Whitney. And the first day, Whitney doesn't show up. Second day, Whitney doesn't show up. And now they're booking these studios out at, I mean, it's Criteria, and it's like, I don't know what they're paying for this place, probably like $2,000, $2,500 for a full lockout, engineer everything. Third day, Whitney doesn't show up. I'm like, I said to the A&R guy, am I really gonna just come to the studio and wait for Whitney? Like, is this what I've you know, come to my career? The fourth day, he says, Whitney's on her way. Whitney doesn't show up. Fourth day, I'm like, I'm going home. I'm like, you call me and bring me down here when Whitney's gonna come and do this record. So they send me home. A week later, they fly me back to Miami. First day, Whitney doesn't show up. At this point, I'm losing hope. I'm like, this record's never gonna happen. It's never gonna happen. The second day, Whitney finally shows up. She comes into the studio with Bobby.
Oh.
And she introduces herself to the engineer and says to the engineer, doesn't look at anybody else in the room, just goes up to the engineer and says, Rob, love your production, love the record. The engineer says, I'm not Rob. She goes, that's Rob. Whitney gives me one look over, and I guess the embarrassment kind of like made her feel funny.
Right.
So she gives me like a little hello. So it kind of like, for her, for whatever reason, it started off on the wrong foot. And it, like, I had to kind of try to turn this around in a subtle way without being like all over Whitney and making it like I was like, oh, Whitney. You know what I mean? I wanted to do it in kind of, I don't want to use the word cool, but a kind of like just a natural way, like to get back, you know, kind of, because she's embarrassed, because here's the whole room kind of sees her do this, and it's like, it throws everything kind of into a little bit of a tailspin right off the gate. So anyway, you know, Whitney's kind of hanging around. She's, you could tell she's not, you know, whatever the term is, she's not exactly all there. Right? And Bobby's not exactly all there either. So she goes into the booth and she starts to sing. And I'm like, for me, this is like a dream come true. I'm like, Whitney's going into the booth to sing
my song.
And I'm like, oh my God, like this could be a highlight for me. And it just wasn't. It was just like, because she wasn't there, and it was like, I felt like, almost like now the label was kind of forcing her in, and it was like, she wanted to do the record, she didn't want to do the record, she's kind of singing it, she's not singing it, she's kind of talking it a little bit. And here I'm like thinking to myself, as she's running it down, I'm like, oh my God, I gotta push this button when she's done and be like, no. And I'm like, this is not where I wanna be right now. I'm like, I just wanna be anywhere but in this studio. But, you know, so sure enough, you know, Whitney finishes and I push the button. I'm like, that sounds like a good warm up. I'm like, it sounds like, you know, you're getting warmed up, but let's roll it again. Cause I'm like, at this point, I'm not gonna get her any criticism or nothing. I'm just gonna [S2] Right. [S1] Be like, sounds good, toned good. I mean, let's try it again. You know, just lock your time in a little bit more and, you know, just, you know, try to feel the groove a little bit more. Right. Sure. So she does it again and it's just not right. So I don't know, I mean, maybe she could see it on my face at this point. You know, she finishes the second take and she's like, I want everybody out of the control room. So she clears out the control room. So it's just me, the engineer and her at this point, and Bobby. But the funny thing is she wanted the engineer out of the room too. And I'm like thinking to myself, wait, he's gotta do the Pro Tools. He's gotta record. So I kind of have him on the floor, like, so she doesn't see him. So he's working the keyboard to the mouse like this, so she doesn't see him. And I'm like, I'm just thinking to myself, this is a mess. So I start doing, like, you know, like, let's do a verse at a time with Whitney. And so I start singing the line to Whitney. And before I could finish singing how I want the line to come, the phrasing to be, Bobby sings it. So I'm telling Whitney to sing it, and every time I would sing it, Bobby would sing it. And I'd be like, all right, thanks, Bobby. I think, you know, she's got it. So then we get the next line, and then Bobby starts singing it. And then, like, at the top of his lungs, he's singing it. And I'm like, by like the second verse, it's just like, it's falling apart, and it's falling apart quick. So all of a sudden, like, Whitney's like, I'll be right back. Whitney leaves, right? So the record doesn't get done. I have like half a verse, I have half a hook, I have a background singer do all the backgrounds. So, you know, at least I have that. I come into the studio the next day thinking Whitney's gonna come. And I get in to the studio that day, and I say to the engineer, play the track. He plays the track, and all my music has been changed. The whole track has been revamped. Every instrument is different. Bobby sat there the whole night and reproduced my song without anybody's approval. So I'm like, I'm in awe. I'm like, what is that? I'm like, that's not the record. He's like, no, Bobby reproduced the record. I'm like, that's it, I'm going home. So I go home, LA calls, and he's like, I think what we need to do, he's like, because they still want to cut the record at this point. They want to get Whitney's vocal on the record. He's like, I think what we need to do is get Babyface involved. So he's like, but the problem is, he's like, you're going to have to split the production with Babyface. I'm like, well, are we going to rework the track? Are we going to rework the song?
Wasn't LA partners with Babyface?
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, okay.
So he's like, I think that's the only way we can get this record done. Because she's like, Whitney like will only work with Babyface right now. And they're the only ones who are, like, her and David Foster and Babyface are the only ones that are getting vocals done for whatever reason. I'm like, you know what, whatever. Do what I got to do. But I'm like, I say to L.A. Reid, I'm like, I would love to work with Face. I'm like, why don't we, you know, get into the studio the day before Whitney comes in and at least tweak the track and you know, maybe update a little bit. Because now, like, you know, why not have Face's touch on there? If he's going to be a producer on it, you know, why not do it? He's like, it's a great idea. I'll talk to Babyface and we'll do that. So I go in, you know, meet Babyface in Atlanta. And, you know, I go into the studio. And I say to Babyface, what do you want to start with? You want to maybe replay some keys or play bass? He's like, I'm not touching a thing on this record. This record's perfect. So sure enough, Whitney doesn't even show up to those sessions. Somehow, and I don't know how it gets done at some point with Face and Whitney, and I'm not even there. So they get the vocal done on the Love That Man record. And the next time I hear it, it's mixed and it's done. Very, very little involvement on my part in terms of time spent with Whitney. The funny thing is though, is that the next week I was going to work with Jessica Simpson, and I guess Bobby got word that I was going to work with Jessica Simpson, and I was in the studio with Jessica Simpson, and I get a phone call from Bobby because I'd exchanged numbers with him. And I pick up the phone and he's like, I gotta ask you one question. How does Jessica look? I'm like, bro, I give up. I'm just gonna get a job.
So it's on the eve, ironically, of her new VH1 reality series on going around the world defining beauty. So she has, I guess, a new independently released song. But this was something you did, I guess, two albums ago?
Two albums ago, yep. So it was funny because we actually did it. We did it Nashville style. I went and met her down in Nashville, and we sat in a room, which was really odd for me because at this point I was doing so much to track. and we sat in a room with a piano, and I played piano and just sat and wrote the song with her. And what was odd is I actually, is when we were gonna cut the record, I went to produce the record, but I forgot a lot of the chords and like what key the song was in. So I almost had it, cause we didn't record it. So here I'm like trying to remember the song and the changes. I wind up cutting the track in the wrong key. So when she comes in to record the vocals, it's in the totally the wrong key. And I'm just like, she's trying to sing the hook. And I'm just like, what's going on here? Like, she was singing this hook fine in Nashville, and she couldn't get the hook. And I'm like, oh wow, this record's not, I felt like the record wasn't gonna get done. We dropped the key like three semitones down, and she finally got the hook, but it was like, I didn't think it was gonna happen, because when she was getting frustrated, she couldn't get the key to the song. Like, she couldn't reach the high part to the hook.
But this became the title track.
Yeah, it became the title track. They were supposed to use it for, they were in talks with Maybelline too. Like, there was a huge campaign around the song, and I don't know what happened, it fell apart, because it's in the skin. And it was gonna be like the Maybelline like theme song for like this whole campaign, and it fell apart. I don't know, I wasn't obviously involved in that part of it, and it fell apart. I was excited about that.
So no drama working with Jessica?
No drama working.
Joe Simpson interventions or anything like that?
No, I didn't even see, I think Joe came in once. She was with her mom, you know, the times that she came in to work with me, it was pretty smooth, which is weird. I wasn't used to it being so smooth, but it was pretty smooth.
Okay, then I'll play you one other thing. We'll try this track here. And you can start telling us about this one. So if we're going to do the Rob cinematic story, we're going to start with Tie a Yellow Ribbon, and then we're going to have this song. Any of you familiar with that song? Well, wait, just a couple people shaking their head, no. How many of you are familiar with that song? How many of you have never heard it before tonight? Okay, well, not to put words in Rob's mouth, but I think this is one of a song that is one of your favorites.
It is. Favorite Queen song. by far.
That's a group, Freddie Mercury and Queen. The song's called Radio Gaga. Gaga. So it's been documented in the New York Star Ledger and several newspapers, the Rob Fusari story about this NYU student who takes the bus out to, is it Parsippany? And most of you are probably familiar with this, and if you're not, you better be after tonight. So Rob, in his quest to expand his horizons here, decides, I guess you're going to do it this time with not someone else's stuff, but you're going to create something of your own.
I felt like everything I had done was leading up to this moment in a weird way, because I wanted to do my own artist. I had worked on so many other artists through my last 10 years of my career, and I was aching just to do my own artist, and I wanted it to be very Strokes like, very lo-fi, simple, like grungy pop, but garage. But I wanted it to be female, because you know, most of the records I had done had been female, and I felt like I wanted to stay with the whole female thing, because even the stuff I was hearing in my head for the production and the songs was female. It just had female screaming all over it. But I had I had a very clear vision of what I wanted, but I couldn't find the girl to front what would be my female Strokes, and it wouldn't be a group. It would just be one girl. And I started putting the production together. I started writing songs. And
was there any inspiration to this? Because there's been a history, whether it's Phil Spector or the Runaways, where there's always this Svengali who wants to create this image, this artist. For some reason, it always seems to be female fronted or female involved.
Right.
I mean, was there any sort of path or charter, or is this just? It just is the way it
evolved.
I
mean, there definitely was. I mean, she would never admit that. I mean, and I would probably never even say that, because I would never want to take anything away from her extraordinary talent, and she is extraordinarily talented. But I mean, I feel like the vision was ours. Let's put it that way. We had a shared vision, Stephanie and I. It was a shared goal. It was a shared vision. I mean, we just saw eye to eye on everything imaginable creatively.
How did you find her? How did she find you? What was the connection there? I mean, it seems like two ships.
Yeah. Well, I had started putting the word out to some people that I was working with, writing with, that I had this idea I wanted to do this female Strokes thing, and if you knew anybody or you came across anybody, let me know. Because I would really love to just focus on that and stop for a while doing productions and on other artists, and stop writing and trying to get on projects. Because that was starting to fall by the wayside fast. It was starting to go south, like getting on projects, because everything started to get tighter. Budgets, labels were with the downloading, and the business was going south in a lot of ways, and it was harder and harder to get on projects as a producer and a writer. So I mean, a lot of producers were starting to, to make the move in terms of trying to find an artist.
So this was your quest to have your own identity and hopefully shape and control your own
Absolutely.
Destiny.
Absolutely. Like I said earlier, I felt like everything was leading up to this moment. Mm-hmm. And it kind of was. So I get a call from this girl who I put the word out to late one, I think it was like a Friday night. And it was really late. And I rarely even pick up the phone, even when it's like daytime. But when I picked up that phone that night, and it's probably a good idea, because who knows what would happen if I didn't. And on the other end of the call is a friend of mine, this girl, Wendy Starlin. And she says to me, she goes, and she's in a crowded room, and I could tell she's in a club or whatever. She's like, I think I found the girl. And all I said to her was, put her on the phone. Because I wanted to hear the girl's voice that could be my girl. And she put Stephanie on the phone. And I don't want to say like I knew at that point, but it was just something kind of struck me. in a weird way when she got on the phone and said hello. There was this confidence, there was this air about her, there was something. And, you know, I said to Stephanie, I'm like, I heard, you know, you rocked it, because, you know, Wendy did say that she was seeing her perform that night. And, you know, it was funny, because I was trying to talk to Stephanie, and at the same time, I was kind of on the internet, because I was trying to type in her name to see if any music would come up, so I can get an idea of
did that YouTube video exist then?
No, it didn't. What did exist, though, is she had a Pure Volume page. She didn't have a MySpace page at the time. She had a Pure Volume page. And I actually got to the Pure Volume page while I was talking to her, and I was listening in the background. And, you know, it was cool. It was definitely somebody that I wanted to meet, so I invited her to the studio that next week. And she came. And
she took the bus.
She took the bus from New York, and it was late one weeknight, and she came, and I first saw her in a pizzeria near the studio through the window, and a buddy of mine was with me, and he said, I think that's the girl. And I'm like, that's not the girl. I'm like, that's definitely not the girl, because it wasn't the girl that I wanted. It just wasn't what I had saw in my head. So he's like, I'm going into the pizzeria. I'm going to see if she's looking for Rob. He goes in. Sure enough, he comes out walking. Comes out walking with Stephanie, and she gets in the car, and I'm like, she doesn't look like an artist to me, and I hate to say that, but you know, she just looks like, it's like she's like, I don't know, she just didn't look like an artist.
No star power oozing out.
Not really. It's like not, or at least maybe it was just not what I thought would front my thing, you know. It just wasn't it for me, and I just remember, you know, going back to the studio, thinking to myself, I got to cut this short, because I want to get home, you know. And so she came back. She was very sweet, like really a sweetheart, you know, nice personality. You know, she started telling me she was shopping to all the labels, and there was interest from various labels, but there wasn't. It was all, you know, BS. And you know, like it was. I knew, like, I had to get her back on a. I think the last bus out of Parsippany was 10:40, back to Port Authority, and I knew if she missed that bus, I'd be driving her back to New York, and I didn't want to do that. So I was watching the clock very closely to make sure she was getting on that bus, the 10:40 out of Parsippany back to New York. But I wanted to be courteous. So before she left, I'm like, you know, well, because she didn't come with any recordings or anything. I'm like, I told her I had heard the Pure Volume, and I'm like, it sounded cool. It sounded like some Gwen Stefani kind of wannabe kind of stuff. So but before she left, I invited her into the control room to play the piano. And, you know, it's funny because she sat down at the piano, and then the way the control room was set up, the piano was here and it would face the wall, and I was behind her, like kind of where you are. And she starts playing a song that she wrote called Hollywood. And like the first, I still remember like the first couple of lines, it was like, listen, I got the sickest ambition. In the mirror, I am scared. Don't know who the hell is there, or something like that. And I just remember like, kind of like, it's almost like I was like a sweat came over me. I was just like, oh my God. Like this, I'm like, this is gonna change my life. I'm like, I finally found, I'm finally sitting in the room, and I don't want to take away anything from any of the artists I had previously worked with, because they're all very talented singers, and so some of them actually songwriters, and that's a specific thing. It's a specific talent. It's a specific artistry. But this was something different. This was the full package. This was the writer. This was a girl playing the piano like I had never seen before. She was moving her body in such a way I had never seen somebody play the piano before. And it was like a brick hit me over the head that I was like, I could finally do something with my talent. I could finally do something real. I could finally know what it's like and I don't know why this all just went through my head in such a short time, but I did. I was like, I could finally do something with the Freddie Mercury of our day, or like the David Bowie, because I just saw this girl as that.
Within the first couple of minutes.
In the first couple of minutes, just after Hollywood. I mean, I don't even think I heard much after the first 15, 20 seconds, because I was just, my mind was going a mile a minute. It was just like, what do I do now? Like, what is my move? What is my move? I can't show I'm too excited. You know what I mean? So I gotta play it cool. And I'm not gonna talk contract after she finishes. So everything's going through my head, like, how to deal with this. I'm like, I want her just like, I just want her to move in and just start working. You know what I mean? But she finishes the song, and I'm like, wow, you're amazing. I'm like, play me another one. So she plays me another song that she wrote called Again and Again, which actually went on the Fame, one of the releases, I think, like Canada, or one, it wasn't in the States. She plays Again and Again, and here I start to see a whole nother side of her. It's like, it's almost like some 50s doo-wop, Oh Darling, Beatles writing going on. I'm like, what the heck? I'm like, this is like, I don't even think she realizes what she could do. So anyway, like, you know, after she plays, we reconvene to the lounge, and like, she's talking to my buddy, and like, my girl is there, and they're talking, but I'm just like in my own world. I'm just like, I gotta do this. I'm like, nothing, now all of a sudden, nothing else matters. Anything else I was working on or trying to work on, it just doesn't matter anymore. So so the next, I let a few days go by, and I call her, and I'm like, I just wanted to approach this very easy. I wanted to approach it very, like, casual. I didn't want to be like, I want to sign you to a production agreement, and I want to have your firstborn, and I want, you know, all the rights to everything. I didn't want to do that. So I'm like, Steph, what I want to do is this. I'm like, I want to offer you a really kind of mild, easy contract that says, I'm going to be the guy to set up meetings for you, to take you in to the L.A. Reeds of the world, just so you could sit down and play, do for them what you did for me. I think that's all we have to do. I think that'll be enough to secure your deal. And then at that point, I'll be covered under contract. If you want to use me as a producer, by all means, I want to write with you. She hadn't written with anybody before, so she was like real squeamish about it. And I'm like, Steph, I'm like, I'm the easiest person to write with, like, imaginable. Like, if you don't want to try, we don't have to, but I'm like, just, if you want to do it, just, let's just do it one day. If you hate it, we'll never do it again. But I wasn't pushing myself on her creatively. I was just like, let's get something that I'm protected if I get you a record deal.
And what did she know about you at that point in time?
She knew everything. She knew all the records I had done. She knew my background. She did her homework.
So she researched you, and she knew who you were.
She knew everything, yeah. She knew artists, she knew dates, she knew A&R people. She knew everything. She had done her homework, and then some. So she agrees to do the deal. She's like, that sounds really fair. She's like, you know, talk to my dad, whatever, and we'll do the deal. At that point, I had given her the deal a few days later, and I guess they felt that it was a little too strong, even for what we were trying to do.
Who's they?
Her and her father. Because at this point, I started to realize that her and her father were really kind of...
He's not an attorney.
No, he's not an attorney. He's an entrepreneur. He's done, you know, a lot of businesses, and, you know,
and she's still a student at this point in time at NYU.
She's still a student at NYU. At this point, I start to try to put it into her ear that I think you should leave school. I'm like, you know, what are you doing in school? I'm like, you're at the perfect age to try music. Like, you got to convince your father to just let you do this full time. Like, this shouldn't be a part-time venture for you. She's like, yeah, I know, but he wants me to go to school. I'm like, well, I'll talk to him, you know, and see if I could help with that. But anyway, they get real squeamish with the contract because they don't want to sign anything. Like sometimes artists, you know, it's the way it is. It's tough. So for whatever reason, her attorney and her dad tell her to just cut off all ties with me. So don't work with this guy. We're not going to do anything with him because we don't want to do a contract. So for whatever reason, she's still calling me and texting me at that point. Like, we're going to work everything out. I know now that there was no intention to work everything out. I let it go for like a week, but after a week I was just like, I got to kind of stay on this. It was kind of like going after, you know, the girl who you want to date. Like, I got to stay on her. I can't let this slip away. So at that point, her dad and the attorneys come up with this idea that instead of her signing a deal with me, we'll just start a company together. You know, so we'll all be part of this company. Myself, Stephanie's dad, and her. And that way, you know, they're not losing creative control. Everybody's, you know, involved in the company. It's not just like, you know, Stephanie's lost control because she signed to a producer. And I was like, you know what, whatever. I'm like, if you guys are comfortable with that, let's work it out. So we wind up working it out. At that point, I guess they give her the go ahead now to start working with me. I do a writing session with her. She finally agrees to do a writing session. And for whatever reason, I just start to think that as great as this is, I'm thinking like I'm getting this little bit of Vanessa Carlton, Fiona Apple thing, like after the writing session that night. We wrote a song called Wonderful the first night we worked, and it was a great song, and it was really cool, and it was, you know, it was Beatles. It had those elements that I really loved about her. But as we continued to work, I started getting this singer-songwriter sense from her, and the way the music was going.
That's not the direction you wanted.
No, because I don't think that was really her. I don't think that, you know, her sitting behind a piano doing, you know, Fiona Apple was really...
The world doesn't need another Fiona Apple or...
Totally.
You know.
And, you know, I felt like she was more of an entertainer. And if there was a way to kind of start to shift this in a different direction, then we needed to start to do it. Plus, like, you know, we recorded like 5-6 songs. And, like, you just know when you start playing stuff for people, and it could be anybody, if you got something. And I just don't think the reaction, like, from the 5-6 songs we did was there. It just wasn't like, oh my God, you know? So I started to second guess a lot of this because I was like, well, I'm like, I did a contract based on the fact that I was just gonna do meetings with her. You know what I mean? But now it was definitely taking on a different role. It was taking on, you know, the role of development. You know, so at that point, I approached her and her dad, and I'm like, the contract's not going to work that we have. You know, the agreement's just not going to work. And they were like, you know, that's not cool. You know, you're kind of changing the agreement. I'm like, I only want to change the agreement because I don't think we could just take her into the meetings and have her play like I originally thought. And that was just me being honest. I just thought that it would come off too singer-songwriter-ish. It was like, there wasn't enough wow factor to the whole thing for me. I don't think the labels would have got it. So we finally worked all that out, and there was one turning point that I realized that here I am, like I did all these like dance kind of urban records, and here I am like producing this girl. And we're using like a lot of live drums. We're doing a lot of guitar heavy records. And it's real, it's just too organic sounding. So one day I just say to her, I say, I would love to try to move this in a little more of a dance, electric direction. And she was really kind of like hesitant about it. She's like, I love what we're doing. She's like, why are you second guessing it? She's like, you know, you don't believe in me. Like, but, you know, she just went on and on. I'm like, except that's not it at all. I just, you know, and at that point I had, you know, I had an article with me that was written in the Times about women in rock and how difficult it was becoming for women to break in rock. It's like, I'm like, Steph, listen to rock radio. I'm like, how many women are being played on rock radio? It's just such a hard market for a chick to get to. It's like Chrissy Hynde, you know, I mean, name me five women being played on rock radio. And we're doing like rock radio records. You know what I mean? Like these aren't like records that are going to get Z100 off the bat. Like they sound like they'd have to break rock radio. Because some of the stuff was almost like, you know, some of the stuff that never even got heard was like borderline Nirvana, you know? So, you know, I pleaded with her to start to flip it. And what we started to do was a whole different approach. And the approach changed. It went, and once it went to this, it never went back. It went me on an MPC drum machine and her sitting at the piano. And that was the way we created every record from that point on.
So the pivotal point there is, you felt there was some magic there, and then it became this singer-songwriter, if you pardon the expression, Tori Amos, Fiona Apple
right.
thing, which you knew the world wasn't ready for another one of those.
Right.
But you saw this pop rhythmic thing, and you sort of turned it sideways and made it go that direction, which made all the difference in the world.
It did, because once
is there acknowledgement to that effect?
From?
Historically, other than from your point of view,
I don't think so. I don't think she would ever say that. I don't think she could say that. And I mean, that's a shame. I mean, but I understand it too, because again, it goes back to the Matthew thing. It's like, why, like who the 12-year-old girl who's listening to Lady Gaga.
Doesn't want to know there's a guy in New Jersey in
yeah,
the studio.
Yeah, it's like, it kind of, maybe it takes away. And
it's the Wizard of Oz.
Yeah, maybe I'm starting to come to terms with that finally, late in my career, that it's not about me.
By the way, it's not late in your career.
Well, I mean, all those times where I kicked and screamed right. about it, be it Beyonce or Will, you know, maybe that's better. Like, that's the way it's supposed to be. Did it hurt when she started going on all these interviews and I was waiting for my name and all I got was he gave me the name Lady Gaga? Yeah, it did.
That's more than Will gave you at the end of the movie.
Yeah, exactly. A lot more. But it's still, I took it as an insult. I gotta be honest with you. I'm like, that's what she's crediting me for, the name? I'm like, she could keep that. I don't want that. Like, that makes me, it just, and that's the way I felt. I'm like, I don't know if it's right or wrong at this point. I think, like, I started to think, like, maybe it's like I'm just a little bit, because I felt like it was my thing too. And I'm not trying to take away from her. It's not that. It's just we worked towards something together, and I thought we had gotten there together, but we didn't. She had gotten there.
But did you ever see yourself as the conduit to help people get from point A to point B?
I think that's what I'm saying, is that maybe that's my role.
But that is the traditional role of a producer until very recently, where the producer has taken almost, you know, equal billing with the artist, but it's always been traditionally the role of the producer to help craft, find the songs, put the bands and songs together. It's almost like what an A&R guy does, and yet, you know, you get a little byline on on the end of the sleeve.
That is what it is. Yeah, I mean, that's what it is. You got to come to terms with that, and you got it.
You have to be able to live with that as a level of acceptance, and hopefully, you know, the financial compensation will assuage your
right.
Your pardon my say the phrase that your
right,
ego.
Right, but I think, you know, true musicians, which I do consider myself one, like that. There's something about the recognition that really brings it home. It's like it makes it real, and I don't know why that is. I think that's just the musician in me, and that's the sensitive part of me that just makes it. The accomplishment from Gaga saying, "Rob, we did this," I'm Barbara Walters, whoever, as opposed to me getting a check, it doesn't compare. But like you can't write enough. That check can't be enough to compare with the girl that I feel that I nurtured and found and was a big part of why it happened. I mean, you know, I mean, and again, like, it wasn't just the music. It was me getting her the deal. It was me getting her the second deal. It was like, it was me, you know, it wasn't just, okay, here's this guy doing music. And I'm not trying to take credit. I'm not like, look, no, give me the credit. It's not that. But it wasn't like this guy just doing music and like, here, go and go get the deals. And now I'm going to go work on the next thing. Like, I'm going with her to every meeting.
You viewed it as a partnership.
Absolutely. And it was. And the way that we set it up was a partnership. We were in a company together.
Somebody forgot.
Right. And it's like I said, that's what it is. And I don't know. And I mean, look, I mean, I got word, I know I'm jumping around, but I got word, I guess, 6 months ago that she wasn't going to work with me anymore. And I didn't get word why. I got word.
What do you mean you got word? Here's somebody who took the bus to Parsippany to meet you in a pizza parlor, and you get the word? There's no communication from your friend
Stephanie?
She would
never say that to me. She would never say it. So,
so I guess she has someone else deliver the message.
Kind of. It was like done in that way. Kind of done that way, yeah. And when I was in LA when I got the call, and it's just like she doesn't want to work again. I'm like, what? I'm like, what does that even mean? So, I didn't really know how to deal with that, because that was like, I just felt like, I use the analogy of like, of going into a store with somebody, buying a lottery ticket, and you give the lottery ticket to that person to hold, and then you never hear from them again. That's what I felt like. And again, look, she's way more talented than me. This isn't about talent, and this isn't about me being, wanting to be in the spotlight with her on stage. It's not about that, you know. But for me, the final straw was, I don't want to work with Rob anymore, right? So, in my emotion, like I get a call for an interview. A couple days after that, and I'm emotional at this point, and I kind of want to retaliate. It's human nature. I want to retaliate, and I want to let Steph know I'm upset, and I'm gonna tell this interviewer that I'm upset, and I know it's gonna get back to you, right? So I go on to do this interview with Lifestyle magazine, and they start asking me like really stupid questions, and I start to get even more like perturbed. They're asking me about her boyfriend. They're asking me about what she does in her spare time. Here I'm like, I want to talk about the record. I want to talk about my part. And they're talking about all the other, like what she's for breakfast. So then, you know, I get quoted, and look, I said it, and she knows me, and she knows I'm emotional, and I said stuff like, well, you know, when it comes to her boyfriend, that stuff doesn't even faze her. She's got like a tin heart, you know. And you can imagine how the press runs with that. And all of a sudden, the press starts saying, like, Gaga's got no heart. She's from the Wizard of Oz. She eats men up and spits them out.
Man eater.
Yeah. So I said. I tried to spin it because I realized that I wasn't doing the right thing. So I start to try to spin the interview, and I'm like, she'll probably eat this up and spit out a great lyric from it.
I was gonna say tin heart.
Yeah, and they spin it as Gaga eats up men and spits them out. Not she'll spit out a great lyric. So the whole thing inside of me being trying to like get to her a little bit, and you know, give her like a little sting, just backfires even more. It's just like now like.
No, see, no. If you had a manager, he wouldn't have let you do that interview.
No, but I probably would have done it anyway.
No, he wouldn't have let you. He would have stopped you.
Right.
So, back to, you know, the challenges. So you guys decided this electro pop thing is the direction to go, and she finally buys into it. Okay, so that just can't be you walking down the street and go, here's a platinum artist, guys, because the music industry has a wonderful long time history of not acknowledging hits. I mean, you know, going back to the Beatles, if you will, right. where they said, ah, these guys suck, we're not signing them. So, right. so what were some of the challenges that you had, you know, walking around with these songs?
So, I mean, honestly, we did one record that opened up the floodgates. We did a song called Beautiful Dirty Rich together. And it was like, once I had that song on my hand, it was pandemonium, because every label started to call and they wanted to meet her. So we were doing like Nobu every other night of the week, sushi, meeting with...
Nobu's a famous overpriced Japanese restaurant in New York City.
And like all these like, you know, A&R heads are just like, you know, they all want her at this point. They're just like, they're head over heels.
So everybody's chasing you.
Yeah.
So new experience for you. You're not walking around with your hat in your hand. It's people are coming to you.
Totally.
And so that had to make you feel good.
It made me feel great, because it was still me and her at this point. And
validation that you
absolutely.
Were.
Absolutely.
Okay.
And she was very much involving me in this, which I wanted to be. And it was all good. The one meeting that changed it all was L.A. Reid. We were invited to IDJ, Def Jam. And she's gonna sit and play and do her thing like I wanted from the beginning, but she's gonna do it now in a more of a dance, quirky way, as opposed to doing, you know, sitting down and playing like singer songwriter songs. So she goes in and she plays Beautiful Dirty Rich. Ellie's not in the meeting yet, but I guess like they have some sort of
code
over there where if the person who's performing for the meeting is really good, like he gets a signal. And he walks in during the meeting as they're playing. And it's again where she's against the wall, facing the wall, and she doesn't see him come in. So all of a sudden he comes in mid-song, sits down, and starts like doing the drums on the table. And I just see her start to get a little distracted. I'm like, ooh, like I'm starting to get a little nervous. She's gonna like, you know, mess up. But she, you know, she pulls through. She finishes the song. L.A. Reid stands up, goes over to her. He takes her hand and he goes, "You're gonna change music for females." Big statement. Now I don't know if he says that to like all the girls, but you know what? It felt like he meant it at that point. And he goes, "I want you to stop down in legal before you leave." And like both her and I looked at each other, like, what does that mean? Like, stop that illegal. To do what? And then, you know, we realized after he left the meeting that he wanted her to stop down illegal and do the paperwork that day and sign the deal right then and there. She didn't want to because there were other meetings she wanted to do and we had other meetings set up. But she came back to L.A. Reid because L.A. Reid was just calling from like day to night. He wanted her. He was just like, I'm gonna do whatever I gotta do to sign this girl. Wouldn't stop calling everybody. She decides she wants to do the deal with LA, so she does the deal with LA.
So she's signing with Island Def Jam.
She signs with Island Def Jam.
When is this?
This is 2000, late 2007 now. Late 2007, maybe, yeah, late 2007. We start making the record. We do like three songs and we're just like, we're not getting much, you know, contact with LA right now. It's just like, that was the first and last we seen of him, but you know, we're still gonna make the record, it's cool. But she starts to, and which I think this was smart on her part, she wants to get in front of LA. She's like, why don't we try to get in front of LA and talk about the record and the direction and, you know.
She wants creative input from him.
She does, and she wants to get in his face, which, you know, in retrospect, I think that was a good call on her part. I was just like, Seth, let's just go make the record. Let's give him the record. You know what I mean? Like, why? Like, why even? Like, if he's given us the okay to make the record, you know, let's go make the record. So I guess it's like, you know, now like she goes up there a couple times. She wants to see him. She's waiting for a meeting, and he says he's gonna meet her. He doesn't meet her. We're going out to dinner. He's supposed to come. He doesn't show. Like two times this happened, we go out with like the rest of the label, and this is where I start to feel it. It's like he
lost interest.
Yeah, he's not into it.
And now, had he heard any music?
No, hadn't heard no music.
So he just, like, he wanted it, take it off the market, I have it.
Right.
And
yep. After he had it, like, I guess 4 months, her A&R guy does a meeting with him. He doesn't invite anybody in. A&R guy starts to play Beautiful Dirty Rich. And this is, I wasn't there. This is what Josh Sherman told me. 15 seconds, LA goes like this. Shut it. Drop her. We had cut, like, I guess 5-6 songs under the...
Just like that.
Just like that.
Cold.
He didn't want to hear any other songs. And he didn't even want to hear, like, the hook to Beautiful Dirty Rich. He just goes, drop her. Josh Sherman, huge, you know, he's like your hugest fan. He's like fighting. He almost gets fired because he's fighting with LA on it. And LA is like, don't fight me on this. Drop her now. I get the call that from my manager at the time that LA's letting her go. And I was just like, I was devastated. I'm like, what now? I mean, what now? And of course, like I just landed. I was out of town. I just landed, and I turned on my phone from the plane, and there was just a ton of messages waiting. I was like, oh, that's really good. That's really bad. And sure enough, it was Steph. It was Gaga, and she was just in like hysterics on the messages. She's like, you gotta fly back. You gotta fly back. I'm like on the ledge, you know. It's like, so I did. I went back and I, you know, I kind of got her through it. And I'm like, Steph, we'll get another deal. We'll get another deal. It was a real tough time. But
and for the record, you know, there's a history of artists like this. Alicia Keys was on Columbia Records and was dropped. It was picked up by Arista. Katy Perry was also one of L.A. Reid's projects. He didn't know what to do with her. She was dropped. She was also signed to Columbia Records. So it's not unprecedented in this environment where artists are signed because they want them, and then not so sure. So what she is going through in this process is not that unique.
Right.
But who know? But easier to sit here in hindsight and say that
totally.
When you're living through it.
Totally. I mean, and I did start to get concerned. I'm not gonna lie. I was like, oh, now like trying to go back to these labels and be like, LA dropped her, because it's gonna spread like wildfire.
Right.
Through the industry, that LA dropped her, be like, why did he drop her? He probably heard music he didn't like, or this or that. And I'm just like, it's gonna be.
Or something even worse.
Or something even worse. So at the time, she signs on with the same manager I have, New Heights Entertainment, which I thought was a big mistake, but she winds up doing it anyway. They start shopping her. And at this point, I decide to maybe take a step back in more than one way. Once they started shopping her, I'd cut a couple more records with her, you know, for the new meetings. But I felt like maybe now it was time for me to move away just a little bit and let them do the meetings. I mean, she has this new manager. I mean, they could do it fine. So I stepped back a little bit. But what starts to happen is they're doing all these meetings and nobody's biting and nobody's even taking a second look at it. And I start to get really concerned because my contract, the clock starts to tick again on my contract. I have a certain amount of time where I have to get her into another deal. Right. Otherwise, my contract goes void. And so now the clock is ticking and I have like 3 months left on my contract. And if I don't get her another deal in 3 months, I'm out. And basically all the work I did, she can go wherever she wants. She can do whatever she wants. She's free of our business relationship. And for me, that was just like after all this work and all this time, I'm just, now I gotta let this go. So that's where I step in and start to get more involved in shopping her. And I make one call to Vincent Herbert, the guy who did me wrong on all those deals, because I'm like, look, I gotta do something here. I'm like, because if I don't, then nobody else would sign her. They went to everybody. They did the whole circuit for months. And I knew Vince had, you know, just did his own label with Interscope. So I called Vince. I'm like, you know, because I still talk to him from time to time. We don't do business at this point, but I still remain in contact with him. I'm like, Vince, you know, and obviously I didn't go to him first when it was first time to go around with Gaga. I went to everybody else. Vince was not even in the mix. But now I was in a not so great situation. I had to kind of take the lesser of the evils. So I called Vince and I was like, you gotta check this girl out I'm working with. I sent him to the, she still has a Pure Volume at this time, funny enough. I sent him to the Pure Volume page. He listens to Dirty Rich and another song we did. He calls me back that night and he's like, I need you in LA tomorrow to meet Jimmy Iovine. He's like, I wanna sign this girl. I'm like, we're there. So he sends the tickets. I go out to LA with her. We go to Interscope the next day.
By the way, the difference is this time he sent you the tickets.
Yeah, totally, totally. And you know, he gave me the whole speech, like, you know, before I went out there. He's like, you know, I'm different now and I've changed and you know, I just want to do right by people. And I'm like, oh, okay, Vince, whatever. So we go to Interscope and it was like 11:30 in the afternoon. And it was always like this with Vince. Like it was 11:30 and he's like, he calls me at 11:30. He's like, you gotta get Gaga here by 12. Like Jimmy's coming in. I'm like, Vince, I'm in West Hollywood. How am I gonna get down to, you know what I mean? So he's got me like rushing, like
stressed out.
Oh my God. And she's stressing out, like, well, you know, gotta go faster. I'm like, sure enough, we get to Interscope and Jimmy never shows up. Like he's with
Whitney.
Yeah. he has a family emergency, he never shows up. So she's there, you know, but now she's definitely starting to look like Gaga now. She's coming into her own. She's starting to dress a little bit crazier. It's starting to be like she's turning heads by all means in the office. Like she's walking through the office and everybody's just like, you know, she's turning heads. Second day, they're like, all right, come back, we'll do it tomorrow. Second day we go, no Jimmy. So like they like Interscope, a couple of the like interns just have her perform in the lobby just to make her feel kind of like there was something going on. So she does like a little piano thing in the lobby. She performs for a couple interns. We go home and like maybe tomorrow, it didn't happen. They send us back home to New York. But I'm like, you know, I'm like, Steph, you know, Vince could probably make this happen without you even seeing Jimmy, which wasn't true, but I was just trying to make her feel better. Anyway, they fly us back out a couple weeks later and Jimmy is there. And it was the first time I had met Jimmy. And it was a very just casual meeting. We walk in, Jimmy's on the phone with Mick Jagger. And he's on the speakerphone, Mick Jagger, and they're trying to locate these lost tapes, these analog tapes, with a song that I guess Jimmy had produced with Mick and John Lennon. So I'm like, Jesus, this is the real deal. And this guy can make this happen if he likes this girl. Jimmy doesn't listen to much music. We listen to like maybe half a song. And you know, after, you know, Jimmy is talking about everything else like in his office about the Mellotron that's there and you know, the John Lennon photos, he stands up and he's like, oh, let's give this a try. So he gives it a try and he signs her. She sits on the label for like 6 months and like nothing's going on. And like I do all these meetings with her and Vince and they're like, yeah, we don't know. We're gonna release a single this, then, whenever. No, nothing concrete. I think what changed it was a meeting that Jimmy had with Akon. Jimmy had played Gaga for Akon in a meeting. Akon flipped out and basically lit the fire under Jimmy. And the rest is history. But as soon as Akon, you know, came into the fold, you know, I started to get pushed out because it was...
There were a lot of people in the mix.
Yeah. It was basically, I don't really need Rob anymore. Like, I got Akon, I got Jimmy Iovine, like, and I get it. Like, she doesn't. She didn't. And that's when I really the push started to get really hard on me, like, step aside. Like, where I used to do everything with her, and I used to be informed, they started, like, not telling me anything, like, what they were doing. I'm like, she would call me, and I'd be like, oh, what are you doing? She's like, oh, I'm in L.A. I'm like, oh, you're in L.A.? I'm like, what are you doing? She's like, I'm working with Pussycat Dolls. I'm like, really? That's great. I'm like, but you know, I don't know why they didn't want to share it with me, but it's like they felt like now is the time to start to alienate me in some ways. So that started to happen.
By the way, any of you guys have any questions, feel free to jump in now.
Songwrite
for her second album?
No, I didn't. They used some of the old songs that I did with her. They threw them on the second album. But by that time, her and I had already gotten word that we weren't working together. So no. No. Most likely won't work with her again. It sounds like yes.
Have you considered working outside the
heavy work? I've done a couple indie albums, indie rock college albums. And it's tough, and it's a business, and like I said before, I am an artist and I am true to the music, but I also fight with staying in business. So on those albums I've done, I've kind of as per time spent and money made, I've kind of lost. So it's like they've been really cool albums, but they haven't worked for my business. You know what I mean? It was like it almost cost me to make those records. You know, because I did believe in those artists so much, and I did the records, but I got a little college airplay and a little nothing really. But I do. I mean, I love stuff that's indie. I love indie feeling music, but I try to I want to take something indie and make it not indie, if that makes sense. You know, and a lot of indie artists don't like that. So, yes.
What are you working on now?
I actually, I decided that I am going to stay with the development of artists. I'm not really going to go, head first back into doing, productions for other artists. I mean, although I do it here and there, but I found a young kid who's 14. I found this kid in Portland. He plays guitar, he writes his own songs, and he produces. And somebody sent me a CD of him. And I had to see it for myself, so I flew up to Portland to see this kid play and sing for me. So I went to his mom's house. And he just blew me away. So I'm probably just gonna do 90% of that. Like, to be my 90% of my efforts could be on that. So it's developing artists all the way.
Of course.
Since it's getting late, do you want to play something that maybe they haven't seen?
If you want to, we show the Sony meeting if you want.
How long is it?
I mean, we could just look at a piece of it. We could kind of flip through it.
Can somebody come down here and set that up?
This is actually, we're going to show you a, I took Gaga to Sony ATV, because I was interested in maybe them signing her to a publishing deal at that point, because it was early on in things, and I thought that it would help the cause. They can get involved maybe in shopping her a little bit, and we could maybe get them involved more. So you can kind of get a gist of what it was like being in that meeting. They didn't wind up signing her. They actually didn't want to have anything to do with her.
Yeah.
I just was curious on, who are some of your influences, musically and, on the production side. Who did you listen to help you create?
Huge Beatles fan. A lot of Zeppelin.
Queen,
yeah, obviously. Producers, I love Mutt Lang, I love Spector, I love George Martin, the classics. I'm not a big fan of like the newer, I appreciate what Timberland and those type of guys do, but I'm definitely more of a classic type of guy on the side of producers and artists.
When you sit down and when you meet somebody or you hear them for the first time, what is it that you see in them or that you try and get a feel for that shows you this is the person I want to work with?
You know what's huge for me is when I see the drive, when I see a person has that incredible drive, that for me is like a huge part of, of course the talent. You got the talent, but the drive is, and that's what Stephanie did.
Ambition.
Ambition is huge. Because And she and Gaga definitely changed the way I viewed things with that, because her, like, every day was just like, I mean, I would get to the studio, she would have a list of things we needed to do. Like, just, she just had it. She just, we gotta do this, 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 and she would do them all. And like, her drive, she would go home. And like most artists, when I would send them home with like, all right, why don't you finish the verse at home? They would never do it. And like, she would do it every time, and I used to be amazed. Like, she would come back, she's like, I got the song. I'm like, you do? You know, so that the drive is huge, huge for me. Yes?
Do you feel like you have any goals left that you need to accomplish, like, before?
That's a good question. Because I mean, the thought of trying to do, like, to try and top Gaga is gonna be tough for me. I'm not sure if that, you know, I'm being realistic about that. And you know, it's funny, I've actually struggled with that a little bit. And because I need to, you know, I need to, that's what almost keeps you alive. You know, your goals. Like, it's not money, it's the accomplishments and the goals. And I've been thinking about that. I'm like, yeah, I obviously want to keep developing artists, and I'm just like coming to terms with maybe like I'm the guy who helps, you know, helps nurture those artists. Maybe that really, I need to kind of reshape my goal. You know, whereas my goal before was to have a huge international star. And now that I kind of have that, it's not really what I thought it would be. And it never is, you know what I mean? So I'm trying to reshape it now in terms of why can't it be good enough just to help somebody? Isn't that a goal in itself? And isn't that an accomplishment to help somebody get from point A to point B? I have to learn to teach myself that that's enough. Like, that's good enough. And I can still make money doing that, you know, but.
How was the Grammy win for you? Did you feel like that was like an accomplishment in terms of, like, do you feel like you needed more Grammys or
Yeah, I was never like an award accolade type of guy. So like, you know, it didn't really, I guess maybe it wasn't like, I guess it would have been different realistically if like I were with her and we kind of like, you know, accepted it to get, not that I would go up, it just we were in the same room and we could share the experience together. I would have probably, that would have been a way more fulfilling, you know what I mean, experience for me. But just, you know, kind of, I actually got a call that I won the Grammy from somebody that I had just met like 2 days prior. So it was really weird. You know what I mean? So it was kind of like bittersweet in that. So I think like, you know, to win the Grammy, but to have do it with the artist is the nice part. Yeah.
I know you said that you want to build on this now, but if you had the chance to work with anyone out there today, who would you go?
Artist-wise? Oh, the answer to that would have been the answer when I first started would be Prince. Like established stars, you mean. Prince all the way. But I know Prince will never work with me, so I could dream.
It seems that in your whole story, there's this common thread of you do all this work, and then at the end, you don't get the credit for it. If you were to have an artist who achieved 50% of what Gaga did, maybe even less, but they did all of it and said, you know, Rob helped me and developed this with me and really worked side by side, would you feel that was more fulfilling than having success and not getting?
It's a good question. That's a good question. I don't know, because if they're 50%, they're not going to be in a position that's going to be on Oprah, and they could talk about the experience. You know, I just wanted her to, even if she didn't mention Rob, I wanted her to talk about the experience, but it's not realistic. It's like, why would she talk about being developed when the world, you know, wants to know Gaga as this, she popped out of an egg. You know what I mean? And started playing the piano. And
But people in the industry now know, because of the Billboard
right.
interview, the numerous articles in the tri-state area about your experience and how it happened and how this girl from NYU schlepped out to Parsippany
they
to
do.
Meet you.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the record stands. You can't change historically what happened is the truth.
Right.
So whether she wants to tell the story or not, the story's out there.
Right. It is. But I guess there was just something, you know, I hate to sound like I beat a dead horse, but just there's something about the artist saying it. You know, there's just something about if it just came out of her mouth just once, there's something fulfilling about that for me. And I don't know if that's me just being like unrealistic.
But do you ever hear, you mentioned the Beatles are one of your icons. Do you ever hear the Beatles talking about how much George Martin really contributed to the sound of those records?
No. I guess I don't.
You don't. And you certainly don't hear any good things from any of the Phil Spector artists about Phil.
Right.
So, I mean, you're like.
But George Martin didn't find and nurture and buy lunch for the Beatles for the last 2 years.
But
you know
could,
what I mean?
But you could argue the sound of those records. You go back and listen to them. I mean, he put a lot of traditional classical stuff in there, arrangements. I mean, though not take anything away from the great songwriting, but I mean, those songs would never have been crafted the way they were if it wasn't for his you know, experience. So I think, you know, again, you know, you're asking somebody to have Toto move the curtain back and ignore the guy behind the curtain that's pulling all the buttons.
It's unrealistic. It is. I guess, yeah, it is.
I mean, what counts, quite frankly, other than the satisfaction, inner satisfaction, would be we are all capitalists, and hopefully, you know, your bank account will at some point reflect that, and that's what you have to be satisfied with, is that, hey, I crafted all this stuff, I got compensated.
Right. That's what it is. Yeah, you're right.
Well, I don't want to be right, but I just want to point that out. Sir, in the back there.
I read that you graduated in 2008. Is that true?
Yeah. That is true, I know.
Next question. Sir, in the back.
Yeah, we should have no comment on that. It took me that long.
Who, like, artists like Beyonce and Lady Gaga really have, like, stuff that they're putting out, really them, or is it all like them?
It's really them. Yeah, it's all Gaga now. Everybody's just following the lead. It's all Gaga. Yep.
How many A&R guys do you think now? I need something. I need like a Lady Gaga song. Can you find me one of those?
Oh my god!
Because she's got songs that other people are doing now, right?
Yeah. Actually, I did one that she did with Adam Lambert. I did with her. It was an old song.
That's right.
Yeah.
Young lady in the back.
What exactly did you study here?
It was music manager. Yeah.
It's a sterling example of what you can become.
Yeah.
Come on.
Have you worked throughout your career to maintain your sense of musical accessibility? Like, is it easier to come up with, say, for example, a synth, model synth, or come up with a sound that is just, you know, it's so unique that it could work, like that it's crazy enough to work, or is it easier to keep up with what you know is working and kind of develop it around that?
It's a good question, I'm always, like, looking and I'm listening to, like the newest, when I say like the newest, like I was listening to like Justice like a while back, because I'm like, you can kind of see it coming. And so I'm like, I'm always trying to look a little bit ahead and to try to take that and mold it into my own thing that I do. You know, because like I said earlier, like I know what I do. Like I don't want to try to copy somebody, you know what I mean? So I try to just listen and take what I'm hearing and just make it work for what I do, you know? And I'm like, I don't get too caught up anymore in like programming synths and all that. I'm way more concentrated on the song, because like I've had way more success based on like nobody saying like, oh my God, that track is, or that bass line or that sound is so amazing. It's like the song. It's like my success has been because of the songs, not because of this crazy production that I changed the world of production. Because I haven't, and I don't. But I know how to craft a great song, so I try to lean more on that part of, you know, what I do. Because the song for me is everything. Yes?
If you end up working with a new artist that turns out to be like Lady Gaga, and they don't give you credit to it, like how do you think you'll come to terms with that?
Could that be the final straw? You'll see me in Tahiti, like under a hut. Yeah, totally. You know, I honestly, to answer that, I think this one was the blow. I think this one was the big one. You know, because I just. In fact, I know. Like once I get, and I've gotten through this one, it's all gonna be. I'm almost expecting it. You know, it's like the new kid, like the 14-year-old kid I'm working with. It's like that's what it is. It is what it is.
What was Doug Morris's quote once was, if you want loyalty, get a dog.
Right. There you go.
We're kind of a little late, but I just want to make sure there's nobody out there feeling we didn't get to their question. So, yes.
Yeah,
Lady Gaga's like visual style seems almost like for some people out there in music, do you feel like that's the key sometimes?
Yeah, I in a way I do, and I approached her with it a while back, and she just kind of put me in my place. It was like, yeah, like that's not for you to say. It started like she, before she got signed, she started doing like this burlesque thing, and it was still all my music with her, and it was basically these two girls, almost naked, on stage, doing like this striptease act over these records that I did. And I went to see her at a show one night, and I'm just like, Steph, no. And she was just like, whatever. She just brushed me off and was like, you know, you're not gonna tell me what to do. And to answer your question more straight on, I don't know, because like now I'm starting to think like, what if she wasn't doing that and she was just looking like a Fiona Apple? Would she really be hitting the height she is? Like, I think, you know, she's doing it in a way where people are still realizing that she's the real deal. You know what I mean? Nobody's saying that this girl's a fake and she can't sing and she can't play and she can't write. Like, so I think as long as you have those things to back it, which she does, she's okay. I mean, how long can she do that? I don't know. I mean, how many outfits are you gonna go through before it's like, all right, we've seen all the outfits. Like, what else you got? You know what I mean? So she's good at, and look, she's good at that. She's good at the what else you got, and she might have something else up her sleeve. But she knows that she's gonna have to change it, you know, in some way, shape, or form in the near future.
Once you can't back it up, you don't have that, you can't hold that image, right?
Totally, but like I said, she can back it up. I mean, because she's a brilliant songwriter and a brilliant piano player and a singer. You know, if she couldn't do that, then she'd have a problem. But she can do that. You know, so she's good. I think she's going to be around. I mean, I could be wrong, but I think she's going to be around.
Sir?
Those, like her, like the other ones who failed to give you credit, what do you think they would say if they were like directly asked, like, oh, so what happened with you and this person? Why did you say this? Like, do you think they would be upfront or?
No, I don't think they could. I don't think they could. I mean, that's a good question. I'm not sure what Gaga would say. If somebody, like, what would be the question, in other words? Like, say you were interviewing her, like, what would you say?
Like, I would say, why did your relationship with Fusari end that way, or what happened?
Right. She probably has a stock answer that is very politically correct, and like, you know what, Rob, the work we did was good for that time, but you know, we had our creative differences or whatever. You know, our artists have, they're ready to go with that. She can't, and I know she wouldn't ever say anything negative, and you know, she wouldn't tell the story like it is, you know. And that's what you have to do as an artist. You gotta, you know, you gotta smooth it over.
Guys, we were very fortunate tonight. Not only do we have an alum here, we have a guy who's been involved, crafted, shaped, one of the most important artists and most successful artists in the world today. As big as she is here in America, she's even bigger overseas. And, you know, whether you believe her sustaining power is there or not, the fact is she is, of the moment, one of the biggest stars right now on the planet. And this man here, from humble beginnings here, William Patterson, New Jersey native, has been involved from the get-go and touched many other successful projects that's provided the soundtrack for us over the last decade or so. So I think we're really honored to have him here. We should really thank him for taking the extra time.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.